First Christian Church. We're here, as always, because Jesus is alive. And we're here to worship him. Amen. It's good to see everybody. If you're a visitor, please take a card in the pew in front of you. Fill it out. Put it in the offering plate. Let us know who you are. And if you have a prayer request of any kind, please do the same. And I promise you, we pray for these folks that you put on the cards. Yeah, I missed you last week, and we had a good time over in Boone. But I know Danny Thompson did a great job. I've known Danny for a long time. The ministry he does in the prison is absolutely astounding to me and very needed. So I want to publicly thank Danny for being here and sharing his heart and his ministry. So, okay. A few announcements. I'm not going to read all of them. They're in the bulletin, but a couple of sign-up sheets out in the foyer. Number one, if you're a golden ager, and you know who you are, okay? Or if you're a younger person and you want to go with us, we have an outing to the Farmer's Daughter Market Restaurant. I'll get it right. Farmer's Daughter. Okay. It's a restaurant. And we're going there on October the 2nd. And if you'd like to go, please sign up. And any golfers out there or want to be golfers or think you're a golfer or anything like that, we're having a golf outing on the 3rd. And Mr. Dave Marshall put that together. And we're ready to go. Right, Dave?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So he told me that you wouldn't let him go if he wouldn't play.
Huh?
Something like that. He had to be overnight and you wouldn't let him go.
That's true. That's not true. Larry. But anyway, so I hope you can come on those things. A lot of other things coming up in our bulletin. And before we start, I'd like you to remember the family of Pearl Simmons. You know, we lost Pearl this week. And that's... She was a member of this church and a very important member of it, even though she wasn't able to come here for the last several years. She was always in our hearts. But keep her family in your prayers, please. So let's start off with prayer. Lord, first of all, I want to thank you for loving us the way you do. Thank you for being here with us. I pray that everything that happens in this service would be pleasing to you and bring you glory. And we do pray for the family of Pearl. We thank you for the life of Pearl, that we enjoyed her so much. We thank you, Lord, that we know that she's with you now. We draw great comfort and strength from that. And I pray all of us in this room, Lord, will come to know you as Savior if we haven't already, and we'll all be together one day in that other place with you. We love you, Lord. We ask you to be with us. In Jesus' name, amen. Charlie can't be here today, so here's David.
Thank you.
my mind. Come as Lord Jesus. Right when you can.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good to see everyone here. This morning I'm going to do something a little different at this time of the service. I'm going to talk about myself, talk about Christ. I'm going to read one verse out of the Bible before I start, and when I get through, we will come right back for our service here to show the graciousness of God. In Luke, and everyone's familiar with this verse, I'm just going to read it for, like I said, verse 19, and go from there. And he took bread, and gave thanks, and broke it, and gave unto them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And the word I'm keying on here is in remembrance. As most of you know, I run a small business over in Lebanon. And I've been employing people for about 40 years in the radio business. And I had something to happen to me right before Labor Day that I've never experienced, never expected to happen. And I'm not going into big detail on this because we don't have time. Hopefully, I'll get enough out to show you God's grace. So I hired this man who's well known in the community, and he's got a big ego, and he'd done some work on TV, local religious TV station, and I guess God told me, said, and I've never done this before, to get a contract with this gentleman, and I'm so thankful that I did. And in that contract, there was nothing said about religion, about God, or anything. It was just a regular little contract that said you had to bring in so much money because he was going into sales, and he had to bring in just enough over a 90-day period because he was just on trial period to at least pay for his salary. Well, he was on the air once an hour every day, Monday through Friday, and he loved it. He got attention from people, and he was used to this, and this is what he was involved with, some of the gospel groups over there, and Ralph Stanley, some of the bluegrass people as well. And every month, he was to come to my office and we would go over what he's done and how close he is with his contract. And he didn't want to do this, I found out after he got started, because he was well known, he could have done well. And so It started in July, and I brought him in at the 1st of August and talked to him, and he always come in a minute before the program started, and as soon as it was over, he was out the door. He wouldn't even stop and talk. Because he wasn't out selling, I come to find out. He just wanted the exposure and wanted the great things that recognition gives you when you get, your head gets so big. So I brought him in the second time, and I told him that this, really, I said, you're upset here, and told him what all was going on. And I said, here's where you stand, and it's not looking good. Well, at that time, I didn't know he was getting upset. So about 10 minutes through the conversation, he jumps up and says, I've got him back here and get on the radio. People won't think I'm here. So at the end of that day, that hour, he went out, and my secretary was coming in the parking lot, and he turned to her and said, tell Mr. Yuri I will not be back. And he didn't tell me this. I was unaware of this. She comes up and tells me, and this blindsided me. I thought, well, you know, I can't force the man to come back. I don't know, probably a lot of you people have been on Facebook, and you've seen Facebook, and you may even use it. I don't use it. I'm never on it. I'm sure there's some good parts about it, but the only thing I've really heard about it is a lot of gossip. And you know what God says about gossip. I come into work the next morning, and my people are all up in arms. And they said, have you seen Facebook? I said, no, I haven't seen Facebook. I don't think it is. Oh, you're all over it. Come to find out, this gentleman had got on there and posted a bunch of stuff about me, and that I had fired him, that I had stopped him from praying on the radio. During the program, he would pray a small sentence or two for somebody if they called in and said, maybe my mother has cancer or something like that, and I didn't have a problem with that. I mean, you know, I love prayer. I need all the prayer I can get. The program was going good. And he just was going out and telling customers what I became Satan, in other words. I became Satan in Southwest Virginia. And I couldn't believe what happened. People were calling me on my cell phone, not identifying themselves, and literally cussing me out. And I finally figured out the reason that was happening, that this gentleman and two or three others had decided to jump on me, and they decided to use it with religion because this is the Bible Belt, and everybody knows this nation is in real, real trouble with God with all that's going on. I got more calls. I couldn't go home. Of course, I used my cell phone without getting calls. So this goes on, and I'm praying about it, and I'm asking God what to do. So right before Labor Day, I'm going to shorten this up because it's getting really, really long. Right before Labor Day, about 2 days before, I was praying, and I guess I stopped long enough to take a breath, and the voice said to me, why are you fretting? Why are you worried about this? Don't you remember what I promised you? And that's the reason I read this verse, in remembrance of me. Well, when that came across my mind, I got real humble. I thought to myself, why am I fretting? God knows the truth. I know the truth. Why am I fretting about this? And then I prayed some more, but to get on with the story of what happened, I decided to say, I said, okay, Lord, forgive me. I'm not... handle this well, this testing I'm not handling. I said, Lord, I'm going to turn it over to you. It's what I should have done to start with. So I went to work the next morning, and my people were saying, what are we going to do about all these phone calls? You're getting a ton of phone calls. Said, they're giving us down the road. They're talking about us while we're working for someone like you. And I turned to them, and I said, I tell you what. I said, I'm out of this. I said, don't put nobody through to me again. I am out of this. I've turned this over. And they sort of looked at me and stood around, and I went back to my office. And then the next day was Friday, I came in. And my secretary says to me, says, we haven't got a call today. We haven't heard anybody that's called in and complained, and nobody's called in and given you down the road. And I said, well, I'm out of it. There's no need for them to call me. So the next two or three days, Labor Day come up, and I just took 3 days and went down on the farm. And there was no cell service. And that's all I work off of is a cell phone. Most peaceful time I've had in a long time. So I came back to work the next Tuesday. No phone call. Nobody called or anything. And then I thought to myself, you know, this is God act. This is God doing this. Remembering what he had promised me and acknowledging that and asked for his help. He said, I'll be your shield. Who can be against you if I'm for you? And all these other promises that God gave. And that showed my weakness. And that glorified God. My employees knew all about this. They heard it all. Except my prayers. They didn't hear them. They were getting down the road. And the man's son worked for me. And we were all standing there in the front office. And blew me away. He came in and he said, and he's a good kid. He's about 20-some years old. He said, Lennox, I've never worked for anyone like you. And I thought, uh-oh, here it comes. And he said to me, he said, you're the most faithful. You're the most faithful person I've ever worked for. Needless to say, that like to got me. I say that to let you know in what you're aware of, you don't know who is watching you. During all of this, through all of this, my employees never thought I was angry, never thought I was mad or anything. They couldn't understand why I wasn't up in arms, even before I asked God to take this over. He knew the truth and I knew the truth. With that said, like I say, you don't know who is watching what you're doing or what you're saying. So when God says, do this in remembrance of me, I took that to say, not just that I was here, not just the miracles that I have done while I've been here with you during this time, but remember, this will go forever. Whenever you have a problem, go to the Word. Read the Word. All these things that I say pertain from now throughout time. That's the way I took that. Do this in remembrance of me. And I felt at peace. I had some customers that I lost. A lot of them have come back. And I feel that the rest of them will come back as well. I tell you this, but not because of anything that I have done, but because of what God has done. And maybe you've experienced this in your life. So, as we gather around this morning, the table of God for the Last Supper, think about your life and what you went through, and hopefully you've handled it a lot better than I have, but I've learned a lot. Let's pray. And Father, we thank you today for all the things that you do for us, even those things that we take for granted. We know that you're there and that you're with us, and we have no doubt about that. Lord, help us to forgive, help us to love, and help us to trust. We definitely love you, and we definitely trust you. But Lord, help us with our faith. In Christ's name, amen. Thank you. pray for our offering. Father, it is a great day that we can come and give back to you a portion of what you have so graciously given to us. We ask for your guidance over these funds that we will receive, that it goes to the glorifying of you and of adding to your flock. Father, again, thank you, thank you, thank you. We love you and we worship you. In the name of our precious Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
If you have a bulletin, would you go ahead and get it out and let's look at the prayer list. And you can see that there's a lot of names in the prayer list, prayer request, number of people there, cancer patients, nursing home and rehabs. Also pray for the military people and leaders. Want to add an addition to that is Phil Bolden Mueller, I think.
It's my sister.
That's your sister? Okay. Saying my daughter Cindy is getting out of prison, drugs, is moving with me. Please pray. Is anybody else that we need to add to the prayer list?
Or David Robbins.
They are there now, and they're registered there, or they're there for good, basically.
Susan's parents.
Yes.
And which nursing home is that?
They're at Abington Health and Rehab.
Okay.
Barb, remember my wife, she's having a lot of physical problems.
Gladys, let's pray for Gladys people. Go ahead.
My cousin's wife fall in the crack, and she's on a ventilator. They all need the Lord, but they want to take her off the ventilator tomorrow and just pray.
You say her name again?
Margaret McCracken.
Oh, Barbara? Well, all right. I'll go ahead and read a couple of verses of scripture that has to do with the praying. And it's taken from Ephesians chapter 6, start with verse 18. It says, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. Let's go to word to the Lord in prayer this time. Father, we thank you that you love us, that you care for us in every way. Most of all, Lord, we know that you send your Son to die on the cross so that we may have eternal life. Lord, we pray for all the names that we mention and the names, Lord, in the prayer list. We pray for that you will be close to these people and help us in certain ways that we may be able to share with them our faith, the strength that we receive from Jesus. Thank you for being able to assemble together here, Lord, in this house. And pray that the word that we hear today, Lord, will be strengthened to us and that we would be closer to you. Help us, Lord, in our faith and in our weakness, that everything, Lord, we do it for your glory. Thank you for Jesus again. In his name I pray. Amen.
All right, good morning again, everyone. Thank you, Bart. Thank you, Lannis, for that good testimony. How God take care of us. Connie, you're good over there at that thing. Anyway, before we get into the word, let's stand and greet each other warmly. Hunter will take his class down.
Thank you. just don't
know. Honey, I tell you, I've been doing this and doing that. Have you? Well, good.
Speak through me the words that you want spoken, and that your spirit would move in this place in a powerful and mighty way. May lives be touched. May Christians be emboldened. May people that don't know you, this be the day that they are saved. Give you the glory, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Long time ago, for some of you, it was October of 1974. So that's what, 41 years ago, there was a boxing match that got the world's attention. It was called the Rumble in the Jungle. How many of you remember that? Right, several of you, because you're old. Rumble in the Jungle. It was Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali fighting George Foreman. Yes, the same George Foreman of the George Foreman grills. But it was before he was famous for that. Ali had taunted Foreman for weeks and months before the fight. George Foreman was big and powerful and was favored to win. They thought he'd just take Ali apart. But Ali was sharp. He was smart. He knew his opponent. And so during the fight, he did something that had never been done before. And there's a picture of the actual fight. That's George Foreman on the left and Muhammad Ali in the corner. And that's where Ali was most of the fight, in the corner. He did what he came to be known as the rope-a-dope. You remember that? He knew Foreman was powerful, so he had a strategy against his opponent. So he went into the corner, just covered his head, and let Foreman beat on his body over and over and over again. And then Ali would just cover up, and then when George would get tired, Ali would lower his hand and go, and then Foreman would come in again, just boom, 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 for 8 rounds. And while he was beating, you know, Ali around the body and not hurting him at all, Ali would be taunting him. You know, you couldn't hear it so much, but the announcers on right there couldn't. They said, he's talking all the time. And what he was saying was, come on, George. Come on, George, is that all you got? Come on, George, I thought you were powerful. George, I thought you could hit harder than that. Just taunting his opponent the whole time. And then he'd go into the rope, though. And every once in a while, he'd give a little jab, and he'd go, well, Foreman just fell for it and just threw punch after punch after punch for 8 rounds until he had absolutely nothing left. And Ali sensed that. At the end of the 8th round, George couldn't even hardly hold his arms up anymore, and Ali just went to town and just knocked him out. George went into retirement. I thought, wow, isn't that a lesson? Knowing your enemy, it's a very important thing. We see it all the time in sports. You know, New England Patriots are famous for Spygate. You know, spying on the opponents, what kind of plays they're going to run. In politics, we have Watergate, trying to find out the opponent, what they're going to do. In warfare, we have spies. We're always trying to find out the enemy, what their strength is, where they're weakest, where we can attack, where we need to back off. And in the spiritual realm, it's very important that we know the enemy, because he's sharp and he knows us. Satan is our opponent. He intends to damage us. He intends to hurt us. He intends to knock us out. He intends us to be lost forever. That's his goal. And he has several strategies that he uses to try to bring us down. And that's what I want us to be aware of today. I want to talk about his strategies and how we can be effective against him. First of all, let's say, who is this enemy? Who is Satan? You know, Satan, or Lucifer, is an angel. He's a created being. He rebelled against God. He sought to replace God himself. He wanted to be God. But because God is all-powerful, of course, Satan failed. And he was thrown out of heaven. And Isaiah and Ezekiel were told that Lucifer was thrown out with the angels that followed him. And they were thrown down to earth, where they set up the kingdom of darkness. Satan is powerful. He's called the prince of this world. His followers, you know, evil spirits or demons or the angels that followed him. Lucifer, his name means day star or son of the morning. He's beautiful. He's depicted as beautiful and closely associated with music and worship. You know, and Christians, you know, we need to remember, we don't need to be afraid of Satan. You know, he can't take us by surprise unless we allow him to. He can't possess us and move into our bodies or souls unless we allow him. Because Jesus is there in our lives, we don't need to be afraid of Satan. But we do need to be on guard against him, because he is powerful and he is tricky. But you know, some people live in terrible fear of Satan. They're just fearful all the time. You know, and I thought about this, you know, no wonder. The things of evil are glorified in this culture so much. You know, we can't even watch commercials on TV anymore without some horrible horror flick being, I have to cover my eyes. Because the evil depicted is so horrible. You know, you watch enough of that stuff, I guess you will be afraid, because your mind will be filled with it. And that's not what we're supposed to do. We have Jesus in our lives. If we're Christians, we have Jesus in our lives, and we don't need to be afraid of Satan, because Jesus has overcome him and is more powerful. But then on the other side of the coin, sometimes Satan is taken too lightly. I have a picture here of how he's depicted sometimes. Isn't that how we see Satan sometimes? In our culture, a little guy wearing red pajamas with a pitchfork. You know, Satan must love it when we take him either like that, not seriously, or live in fear of him. Either way, he knows if we do those things, we're taking our eyes off the Lord. And we're looking at him. And when we do that, then we are at our weakest. We are at our weakest when we're taking our eyes off the Lord. And it seems like a lot of people fear Satan and don't give much thought to God. And that's backwards the way it's supposed to be. Satan would like nothing better than to be ignored. As long as we don't look to God. As long as we don't look to God. Either fear him or look at him like that. When we're afraid, we're crippled from doing any real ministry. James 2:9 says this. You believe that there is one God. Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. Why do demons shudder? Because there's a God. Because they know God and they know the judgment that is coming. They shudder in the presence of Christ because of the authority he has over them. Now there's a lesson here for us. It seems like the demons show more concern over God than most people do. They see God and shudder. Most people, a lot of people, especially in our culture now, they don't give him any regard whatsoever. God? God? I don't believe in God. God ain't my daddy. Why do I have to listen to him? They mock him. They take his word for granted. They coast along through life, doing whatever they want to do, when they want to do it, thinking everything's going to be okay, never realizing that the seriousness of that enemy, they're falling right into his trap. I'm not giving God his due. The demons do. So do we. We need to make sure we fear God and not Satan. Satan is powerful. Second point. Second point is Satan is powerful. He's not omnipotent. He's not all-powerful. He doesn't know everything like God. He can't be everywhere at the same time. He's not God. He just wants to be. He only has enough power and influence that God allows him to have in this age. That'll all end one day. But for right now, Satan has power. But he's not to be taken lightly. 1 Peter 5, 8-9 says this. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him. Stand firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. You know, I thought about this. This was written by a man, Simon Peter, who knew how Satan operated. You know, I think Satan was on Peter all the time. He was trying to get him to stumble, and he did. Peter, remember, he got cocky. He said to Jesus, he said, you know, Lord, I don't care if all these other guys run away from you. I will never leave you. I will never run. I will go to die with you if I need to. And that very night, he told people he didn't even know Jesus. You know, Satan was ready. He tempted him and knew where his weakness was. You know, I took the daycare. I drove the bus over to the ferry this week. And something happened there that really kind of startled me, and I think it was a lesson. We went to the usual stuff, and then they had this tiger show. Did any of you see that? The big white tigers? Yeah, man, magnificent creatures. I mean, they had one male tiger there, white tiger, Bengal tiger. They said, I think it weighed 500 pounds. You know, claws like this big around, teeth, you know, really fierce looking. And he was, before the show, this male tiger was walking back and forth inside the enclosure. Back and forth. You know, just looking around. And then something interesting happened. Some of the kids from another school, you know, I guess they were letting them run around a little bit. They were following that tiger around inside the cage. Going, hey, look at me. Hey. They were going back going, look at me, tiger. Look at me, tiger. Look at me. Oh, tiger. And I thought, wow. They're almost mocking this magnificent creature of power. I got to thinking, what if the cage wasn't there? What if there was no fence? happened? There have been mass chaos, people panicking, running, jumping, grabbing their kids, screaming, yelling, get away, the tiger's loose, the tiger's loose, the tiger's loose, whoa. You know, Satan is powerful. Yes, he's caged right now in a sense because Jesus defeated him at the cross, but he still allowed freedom to tempt us, and we are not to take him lightly. We're not to go up and say, hey, Satan, want to tempt me? Come on, tempt me, baby. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Can you do it? Can you do it? He'll tear us up. If we don't have Christ in our lives, we are done. We cannot stand up against the power of Satan. And this third point is this. Satan can look real good. Real good. He's not always depicted as some hideous, you know, evil, monstrous looking monster. 2 Corinthians 11 says, for Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. He's beautiful. He looks good. We can be drawn to him if we're not careful. I got to thinking, what makes a real good temptation? What's a good temptation? And I think it has to look good to us. Doesn't it? Or it probably wouldn't be a temptation. It looks good and we want it, even though we know it's probably going to be harmful to us. You know, I read this story about a mother who told her son not to go swimming. But when he came into the house, his mother noticed that his hair and his bathing suit were wet. Johnny, his mother scolded, I told you not to go swimming. I couldn't help it, Mom. He defended himself. The water looked so good. The mother said, then why did you take your bathing suit with you? In case I was tempted. Isn't that the way it is? Sometimes we go into a situation knowing we're going to be tempted, and we know we're going to get into it. We're ready. We're ready to give in to it. That's how it works sometimes, because sin looks good a lot of the time. A definition of temptation is this: the act of enticement to do wrong by the promise of pleasure or gain. Now, isn't that just like the devil? Getting us to do wrong and promising something good in the replacement? Satan knows our weaknesses, and he comes at us with things that look good to us, but they end up causing us heartache. We all have things that tempt us, don't we? I know mine. You know yours. So does Satan. He knows where our weaknesses are. Some are drawn to sexual sin. Some are drawn to alcohol and drugs and tobacco. There are folks who gamble away life savings. They can't stop. Some people are so materialistic, they end up losing everything in bankruptcy and repossession, not because they lost their job or anything, because they're giving in to worldly temptation. You know, and I got to thinking, we should really know better than that as followers of Christ. Sometimes we fall into it. So what's the deal? What's the deal here? How can we have victory over an enemy who knows our greatest weakness? Well, here's how. By implementing our greatest strength, power of Jesus Christ in us. Too many times we set him off to the side. I'll take this one, Jesus. I'll take this one. You can relax here now. Boy, I must say, he must rub his hands when we say that. Yeah, we touched on this scripture a few weeks ago, but I want to look at it again a little closer. 1 Corinthians 10:13. No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. Think about that. A way out. A way out. That's interesting, isn't it? And it's also important. A way out of giving in to sin and temptation. But I got to thinking about this too. The way out may not be very easy. And you may have to look for it. But it's there. The Bible says so. It's there. But it might not be easy. Imagine this. You're in a burning building. You're 5 stories up. The smoke is coming in under the door. You have nowhere to go. You begin in a panic. Oh man, if I just had a way of escape, I could just get out of this building. Then you hear a voice. Hey. Hey, up there. And you open the window, and there's the firefighters. You're 50 feet below. And they've inflated one of them blow-up things. You know? And they go, jump into the blow-up thing. And you look down and go, what? What? That's 50 feet down. Jump. We'll save you. There's your way of escape. There it is. But is it easy? No. Will it take some resolve on your part? Yes. Will it take some faith? Yes. But there it is. It's a way of escape. I think that's how it is when we're tempted sometimes. We're in a burning building in a way, and it looks good. The difference is it looks good. We say, hey, this is a burning building. Now I'm under control here. I don't think it's going to get to me. In fact, where's hot dog? I think I have me a barbecue. But that's what Satan wants you and I to think. Everything's okay. I'm in control here. I can stop this anytime I want. Those words were probably spoken by every addict that ever lived. Whatever you're addicted to, those words were said. I can stop anytime I want to. And then the fire takes over. And Satan has him, and he laughs. Take the way out. But get ready. It may be harder than you think. You know, I think about, you know, you're with your girlfriend, you're a teenager. Or you're with your boyfriend, and they go, hey, just get in the back seat. It's time to step this thing up to the next level. And you go, oh, wait a minute, that's a temptation. That's a temptation, but is there a way out? Yes, there's a way out, but it might be hard. Because somebody say, well, you didn't take care of business last night with your girlfriend? What's the matter, you gay or something? What's the matter with you? Everybody else is doing it. Why can't you do it? You turn down a beer at the party, or a joint, or tobacco, or smoking, whatever you're going to do. And they say, what's the matter with you? You're afraid your mommy's going to find out. Your mommy ain't going to find out. Why don't you be a big boy with us and do what we do? See, there's a way out, but it can be hard. It can be hard. You may have to pay a price for it. It takes more guts to take the way out most of the time. Any wimp can give in. Any wimp can give in. It's easy to give in. It's hard to take the way out. Now, here's a better strategy. Why not avoid those things and those situations to begin with, where you even need a way out? For example, if you're tempted by alcohol, don't go to the bar. Or don't go to that party where you know there will be alcohol. If you're tempted by lust, cancel the TV channels. Put a block on the internet. And don't get into a situation where you can stumble with your sweetheart. Don't hang around liars and thieves. Be an example to those who are caught up in bad behavior. Don't go along with them. Do what is good, especially if you're a Christian. If you call yourself a Christian, shouldn't we be different? Unless we're not serious about being one. If you're not serious about being a Christian, then that's a victory for Satan, isn't it? Christians who don't act like it. Followers of Christ who don't follow. Phoners and phonies and fakers and posers who give the Lord lip service once or twice a week and then go act like the rest of the world the rest of the time. How Satan must rejoice. His tactics are working. You're taking eyes off the Lord. You're putting them on yourself. How happy he must be when he's got us in the palm of his hand and we don't even know it. How it must grieve God when we say we belong to him but rarely show it. You know, we can have lives that are pleasing to God, but it's going to take effort, people. It's going to take effort. It will take putting God's will first. It may mean giving up things. It could possibly mean getting new friends. Who are we going to serve is the question. Are you going to serve yourself? Who are you going to please? Satan is fine. He doesn't care if we serve ourselves, as long as we don't serve God. He doesn't even care if you believe that he exists, as long as you don't get with Jesus. Whatever it takes to stay away from Jesus is his strategy. He knows us. That's what he's after. It's sad when we fall into his trap. He's powerful. We need to be alert. We need to resist him. Satan must be so happy when we avoid making a decision for Christ. One again. Another week. Wow. I want to close with this scripture. this scripture sums up really good, I think, how we should live. It's Paul talking in Ephesians 4, several verses, but it's not that long. But listen, please, listen very carefully, or read along with me here. This is how we should live. Paul says this, "With the Lord's authority I say this, live no longer as the Gentiles do, for they are hopelessly confused. Their minds are full of darkness. They wander far from the life God gives us because they have closed their minds and hardened their hearts against Him. They have no sense of shame. They live for lustful pleasure and eagerly practice every kind of impurity. But that isn't what you learned about Christ. Since you have heard about Jesus and have learned the truth that comes from Him, throw off your old sinful nature and your former way of life, which is corrupted by lust and deception. Instead, let the Spirit renew your thoughts and attitudes. Put on your new nature, created to be like God, truly righteous and holy. So stop telling lies. Let us tell our neighbors the truth, for we are all parts of the same body. And don't sin by letting anger control you. Don't let the sun go down while you are still angry, for anger gives a foothold to the devil. If you are a thief, quit stealing. Instead, use your hands for good hard work, and then give generously to others in need. Don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. And don't bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way you live. Remember, He has identified you as His own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. Instead, be kind to each other, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as Christ has forgiven you." Amen. Amen. There is a battle plan against Satan. Summed up, it's this. Trust God and live like it. Lord, we have an enemy who hates us. Too often we take him so lightly or don't give him any regard whatsoever. And we fall into his trap over and over and over again. I pray, Lord, that we would be wary of his schemes, that we would look to you in everything that we do, that you would forgive us when we fail. Help us to know this enemy, Lord, and know when he's coming after us. Help us to be strong enough to avoid the temptations and the traps he lays for us every day. And help us to look to Christ, our Savior, for strength. Pray, Lord, there's someone here today that does not know Jesus as Savior, that the blinders would be removed today and they could see your love very clearly and what you have in store for them. Help them come and give their life to you, to repent and confess your name and be baptized into you, and to live powerful, effective, and victorious lives. We love you, Father. We thank you for the victory that we have. Help us to claim it every day. Jesus' name, amen. If you have a need today, we're going to sing. Please come. Please come right now. Don't let Satan win another battle. Let's stand.
Table and to share in this message. Heavenly Father, opportunities he takes to cause us to fail and cause us to stumble. But help us, Father, to rely upon the Word, upon your Holy Spirit, that he might guide us every day, every step we take.